is the underhook. I can switch to controlling this arm and going around the head and settle my Kesa position from there. If I like Kesa and I just want to set it up, if I'm in regular side control, I can pummel to the inside of this frame, push that down with shoulder pressure, bring this arm out, sit through around the head, and now I'm in Kesa. So those are two entries. You can practice those as you're practicing the basic position. But first, I just want to get these basic positional details down. So when I put someone in Kesa, the absolute most important thing is this arm. Nothing else matters as much as controlling this arm. If I don't control the arm on the sit through, I'm not even going to have a position. I'm going to have him taking my back. So controlling this arm is paramount. The way I like to control it is with an elbow catch. So my hand's not even really in frame. My hand will be there as a failsafe, but I'm not holding with my hand. I'm drawing my elbow back. That also has the effect of kind of pulling his arm up. It sort of bends his ribs around my shoulders. Like theoretically, and I've done it, you could hold the position like this with no head if I control this arm. Go ahead and take my back. Yeah. It's hard for him to turn in if he can't get this arm back. Conversely, if he has the arm, it kind of doesn't matter how good the rest of my positional details are. If I don't control this arm, he gets it to the mat. He is gone. So this arm is your lifeblood. If you lose it, I'll talk about what we can do. But for now, let's just focus on controlling it. So for me, that means big elbow pull. Hand is a secondary concern. With this arm, I'm going deep under the head. If I can't get his head off the mat, I'll pull that to pick him up. Then I'll scoop that under. I like to grab the back of my hamstring. You go inside your knee. If you can't reach your leg, that's fine. Just apply pressure like you're reaching for it. Like I'm putting him in a little schoolyard headlock. Now this leg, a lot of people leave it somewhere like here. That's bad because if he were to make a big bridge to this shoulder, I'd have to post on my hand. If I post on my hand, I've lost this arm. If I've lost that arm, as we've established, I've lost the position. So this leg needs to go high. Now if he bridges to this shoulder, my leg catches it. I don't have to use my hand. My hand can stay controlling on his arm. This leg, sometimes people leave it here, and there's a reason to do that. You can trap people, but in general, if I do that, he can throw his leg over. He's got him long enough, then he can roll me back, and now he's put me in the truck. Now the situation has reversed. So a good kind of rule of thumb that I was told is knees down, heels up. So my knees are down, my heels pointed up, my toes dug in. Now, if I want to kind of make it really suck, I don't want to pick up too much because I'm here, I'm really grinding on him, but if he were to just bridge that way, I'm giving him too much of my weight so he can bridge me over. So I roll down and I push in from the side. That's how I get that kind of rib bite. And so the uninitiated might tap the pressure. Fortunately, you were told me he's not that heavy, so I don't think he'll die. But sometimes you'll get people that'll tap just to this what you got. So big details are control the arm, elbow pinch around the head, deep to your leg. Knees down, and it can be up a little bit. It doesn't have to actually be on the mat. This is just sort of the exaggerated. Like, here is okay. This is not okay. This isn't putting any pressure and sitting yourself vulnerable. So you want at least something like that. And then have your partner kind of move around. You should be able to move with him. So if he starts running one way, if I let him go, so run all the way out that way, he can just sit up. So I got to be able to follow him. So he starts running, I'd be able to follow him without sacrificing my positional details. If he starts walking into me, I'd be able to stay ahead of him. Because if he gets his hips too close to me and he gets his hands clasped together, then he can bring me across without me doing anything. Okay? So basic positional details, then have your partner kind of move around, try to sit up in you, try to bridge you over, make sure they can't, make sure the position's locked in nice and tight. Okay?
Alright. Yeah, Brian's fine. I feel like someone else is wrong. Am I wrong? I'm wrong. Okay, no one else is missing. Okay. Let's move on to finishing picking time. So, I've got a very simple move progression that I'll do. And I'm going to go ahead and just show it all at once, and you can work through it at your own pace. Okay? So.
Yeah. The way my voice is different, but you seem
really. Yeah. This is one of those invisible jiu-jitsu things that's kind of hard to describe, but I'm subtly turning my
lat pressure.
Yeah. I'm using this lat here to apply that downward into him, and I'm adding that to this arm pulling him out and his head pulling in that way. So it's like I'm kind of corkscrewing him around his rib off of my ribs. So if you imagine like my ribs a pole, I'm wrapping him around that pole.
I'm making noise here. If you go from the left to heavy.
All right. Just that little twist adds some extra sun. The suck isn't vital to hold the position, but it makes you feel really cool if you tap someone with the position. So work on that. But as long as I've got good control on the arm, you know, don't worry about necessarily tapping people with the position right off the bat. It's a sensitivity thing that develops over time, and then how he's moving will inform how I move, and it's a thing. Anyway, the moves. So the first thing I'm going to start with is what we call a chrome lock, which is basically just a Kimura on this bent arm. This is not the highest percentage submission, but I use it to expose his arm for the further attacks. So the way this works is I put my outside arm here on his elbow like I'm wearing it like a wristwatch. So I'm not going in here. Sometimes that's what people see. I'm just lacing around it. If you're familiar with heel hooks, it's like a heel hook. Then I'm going to S-grip my hands. Then I'm going to walk in and raise. So I'm just applying shoulder pressure like that. So that's that. You can go ahead and get that pat. Then the defense is pretty simple, though. All he's got to do is straighten his arm. He straightens his arm, I lose the chrome lock. But now the arm's exposed to further attack. So from here, I slide up. And it's important that I keep my arm in between me and him, because if I just let go when he straightens his arm and come out, he's going to suck his arm in, and now I'm going to have to fight from there. So I need to keep his arm out. So when he pops it out to defend the chrome lock, I slide in. Then I'm going to push it down. And I can go straight to this Americana. So I can grip like that, push it down, hook it under my leg. From here, I apply that pressure. You could also like do that, like you're finishing an omoplata, but it's a very fragile thing. This puts, like, I have to tap to this because my elbow is bad the second someone puts my arm here. So it's very powerful to do it that way. So I usually just try to squeeze and hit and get the tap that way, and I won't start actually bringing my knee through unless they're being really stubborn. Another move you can do is you can push it straight out. So I can go straight out. Traditionally what's taught is you stand on it like this and then you find the elbow and you push down, but that's kind of floaty and pretty simple to defend. So I found more success by stepping my leg over and then using this downward pressure with my knee and upward pressure with this knee to get the tap. It's still a little bit more sensitivity based. You have to find the fulcrum with your leg. So you might have a hard time finishing this one. If that's okay, don't worry about it, move on. When you push this down, people will defend by turning their arm one of two ways. If they turn it up, there's the Americana again. If they turn it down, which is what they should do, you're gonna have to go knee pinch, and then we're gonna work here to some arm ride. So I won't bother showing attacks from arm ride, but you can just get to that arm ride. And then everyone who's been training here has been doing a bunch of arm ride lately, so that's all those options are good for. So one more time from the beginning. We're here, I've got the arm nice and controlled. I hook here, attack the chrome lock, get your tap, they extend to defend, slide your arm in, straight arm bar, get the tap, they push their arm up to defend, Americana, get the tap, they turn their arm down to defend, trap, good tight pinch. This arm swims back in, doing that frame like I was doing when I was setting it up. Then I climb back up. And you can kind of hold like this, but it's better if you can pin that arm under one of your shins. Hey, any questions on any of that? All right, we're good. Swing my elbow out and go right into my Americana. So you don't have to wait for them to straighten their arm. You can just go right into your attacks if you want to. I'll also mention, out of that group, this Americana is the one I want. This is the highest percentage one. I'm going to do those other moves if they straighten because they're aware of that Americana. They're just not letting this happen. Okay, now let's say we're doing this. I make my switch. I mess up. I lose the arm. Usually what they do is they'll go telephone. So I'm not able to get that arm out to attack it anymore. He's established this position. And I actually forgot, but Brian mentioned it. I'm going to switch to a position called Kesa Gatame, if you care about judo and Japanese terminology. Now the traditional thing is we push this across, we hip out, we go here. So it's like an arm over shoulder. I'll do an intermediate. I connect my hands in what we call a butterfly grip. So I'm grabbing around like this. And it's specifically this grip that I found lets me get this position the tightest. So my grip there, then I'm gonna slide my hips down again and reassert myself in. So I was up here because I was wrapping his arm around my body. I wanted that. But now I've lost the arm and he's gotten it here. So now I can't get as good a pressure there, but there's more space here. I want to suck that space up. So I'm sliding down and up. So I'm closer around his head now in a butterfly grip. Now this is a little tighter position. I have more people tapped to the pressure from this position than from the regular Kesa. So sometimes you can just ride and walk and get the tap. If they can suck that up. Some people can suck it up. I haven't figured out the body trait that lets them do it, but some people don't tap to this. What I'm gonna do is I'm gonna push that. I'm gonna start hipping out. And I'm gonna go to a standard arm over choke. And I'm gonna finish whatever I like to do arm over chokes from there. Which for me, I've already got my grip connected. So all I gotta do is push to here, re-grip my butterfly, which is what I like. Then I sit out. Now there's lots of good ways, turning in. The way I've found that's just the highest percentage for me is I grip and I drop my shoulder like that. So there's, you know, anytime you're choking someone, you wanna make it tighter, you wanna make the triangle there and smaller. So I can do that this way. I can do that by walking out. Brandon Motley used to really like that. I never figured it out. But for me, I drop my shoulder straight into their throat and I sprawl my hips. So I haven't been Kesa. I wanted to do those cool arm locks, but I lost the arm. He went to this. This is the most common thing people do. I start going Kesa Gatame, see if I get the tap. If I can't, push the head, re-grab my thigh, walk out until my head gets on his arm. Now my head's holding his arm in place. Then I can reconnect my hands, and then I'm swinging down. And you can do your favorite finish. I don't need you to do mine, but then I like to do that. So if you don't have a favorite finish yet, try doing that shoulder. Okay? All right. Let's work on that, and then I think we have a bailout, and then we're done. So that's the nature of this entry. They are kind of in like a telephone defense already, so sometimes what happens when you're entering, if they're savvy, they'll get that outward pressure on you. Yeah, so he never lets me really set it. And this isn't specifically for this. This is any arm over choke. You can make a switch to the back. So I can start walking this way and pull them up like that. And then go for my chokes from there. So that's any arm over choke.
Push
that
one time.
Yeah. So I'm attacking. He's pretty savvy. He knows this is a way that he can fight back. It's kind of strength-based. So if I'm really strong, I'll just be like, hey, bro, cool. But I'm just going to push that back in anyway. But if he's strong enough to fight me off, sometimes you won't be able to get your arm over choked. So it's here, he gets that outward flare. And it's just, I can't get enough tension around his neck to finish. So I'm gonna walk up, then I'm gonna use this grip to pull him to his butt and bring my arm around. So I was hooked way over here. As I pull him up, I'm switching that to like a seatbelt. And then I like to just lock in chokes as soon as possible, and I'll worry about my hooks and stuff later, but you can take it back and do whatever you like from here. You can drill that in a second when we're doing this other thing too, because they're both kind of doing the same thing. So now, what do I do if I was going for Kesa and I lost the arm, or I had him in Kesa and he lost the arm? So what I mean by that is I lost control of the arm. He pulled it, because what he really wants to do is put his elbow in between us. This is the worst case scenario for me, because now I'm in danger of him if he gets his head past this arm, which is pretty likely. Now he's just straight up behind me, right? So what I need to do, as soon as I recognize that's happening, I need to post, swim this to here. Now I can just climb back up and settle here. We can go to darts and stuff, but usually they start climbing up. So the second his elbow comes down, he's like getting on his knees and stuff. So what I'm gonna do is wrap up that arm in guillotine. So he pulls his elbow down. That's my cue to come here. He's probably already coming up to his knees. So I'm gonna step and wrap my outside arm around his neck. Then I grip here. Then I'm gonna sit through to here. Then I finish by crunching in. A lot of times they'll recognize the threat and roll over. You can follow the mount, finish from there. You can follow the side control, switch it to a darts choke if you know what that is. If you don't know what it is, just do the basic guillotine finish from the back. So does anyone see that again?
Yes, sir.
Okay, so I had Kesa, or I was entering Kesa, or position, he gets this arm here. So I'm like, oh crap. First thing I do is there, I'm making his underhook weak. He wants that underhook to fling me off to there so he can climb up and take my back. So I'm using my elbow to collapse it. I haven't killed it, but it's not strong. Then I'm stepping up and around because I want to be facing him when he gets to his knees. I don't want him to be behind me. Then because he's climbing up, the space to come under there is usually there. Then I'm just gripping my hands. I like this grip. If you got a way you like to do guillotines, do that. Then step there, swing this foot to his hip. This is the ideal situation to finish the guillotine. Sometimes they kind of beat you to the punch before you can get that leg over the back. They'll do like forward rolls and stuff, fall off to the side. So I can step over to mount, finish by hipping in, or I can come to side control. Then I just switch my arms through, and it's a darts choke, and I can go for that. Okay, give that a try. Again, if you're newer or you're working with a new person, just stick to the guillotine finish from your back. Don't worry so much about the follow-ups. Okay. I think, yeah. So some of those near side attacks work in like underhook Kesa too. I know some people, especially Nogi, they prefer the underhook Kesa. They're a little harder because you don't have this isolated control on the shoulder, but they're possible. That's the only other kind of closing remark I think I have. Does anyone have any questions over anything at all? Could be Kesa, could be other stuff. Okay, cool.
From your personal experience.
I did forget one thing. We'll do the thing I forgot, but go ahead with your question.
What is your personal, since you use this position a lot, do you personally get the chest compression most, or is like...
I think I get the chest compression the most in training, but you got to filter that for like white belt noise, because it's mostly white belts tapped into the pressure. I would say I don't tap as many people that are as initiated. They understand that sucks, but I can still breathe. Whereas a lot of newer people are like, how's
on the recipient end? Like, if John gets me in it and I'm still with both shoulders or one shoulder down, it sucks.
Yeah.
But I was saying, once you start curling me around you like Josh Barnett style,
yeah,
that's a whole nother animal. Where,
yeah. And also, I think people are more likely to tap to position in like training. I would not feel confident at a competition that I could make someone doped up on adrenaline tap to the position. So filtering the noise for that Americana is the highest percentage of movement. That's the one that, if I can get that, that's the one that I want. That's the one that usually once that arm's locked in, they can't get out, and it's a matter of time before I get the tap. Yeah, that would be, to me, the A game for me. Usually I'm doing the chrome lock to get them to pull their arm so I can slide my arm to there and then just push that straight down. That's my sort of preferred
that we have already
plan.
Now we have these that are gonna
any other questions before I show you the funny move?
I'm not sure if you're addressing that at all.
Okay, all right. So this is the trap, and I just stole this from Stephen Cope. I think he actually showed it on his Budo Jake video when he went to New York and did this. So I mentioned earlier that you can lead your leg up and like sort of improper technique as a trap. So if I leave this knee high, and I actually, if I'm doing this, I'll step it back and be like, please set your hook. So he does that to take my back. Yeah, he does that now. So I'm gonna abandon the head, step this leg to the inside, drop down and control the leg. Bring my knee bar, or my pungal attendants. So you are inviting the hook, and you're ready for it. It is risky. You know, if this falls apart, you're just giving up your back. So this is a joke move. I mostly do it if I'm kind of trying to clown on somebody. Do not consider this to be smart jujitsu, but it does work. It is a legit move. So I leave that there, so he'll set his hook. Let go, step in between. Control. Basic knee bar details for me. Straight down the butt. Outside leg cover. If I do that backwards, I'm giving up space that he can use to get at me. So I want inside leg straight down the butt crack like I'm curling it around. Outside leg crosses there. And then I slide up the leg and I finish. And when you're grabbing it, don't hook up at the actual knee because he's just going to triangle his legs and defend. Hook up at the calf. And then you can hold the leg straight for the whole time. Then I slide up. I finish by tipping in like I'm doing an arm. If he does triangle, or obviously that knee bar is not there, I'm going to hip out, knee comes all the way down. That's an important detail on the honey hole. If I leave my knee up and I start attacking his legs, he's going to reach across my head. He's going to sit up, get his knees down. He's going to sprawl, and I'm going to be in a bad position.
So
my knee makes a wall between us. And then my favorite move from here is this little cloverleaf, but you're right. Inside heel hooks there. Your topside ankle locks there. Your topside calf slices there. Your switch to game over is there. You know, if you know leg lock stuff, you can do whatever leg lock stuff you like. Once you get
this is all in the next seminar, right?
There's better people than me to do leg lock seminars. That leg entanglement, all of that is just me stealing from James Parker and George Valdez.
You should injure one more time.
Yes. I leave the knee high as an invitation. He sets that hook, step in between. I hook up. Remember, I want to be above the knee, fight down, cover, slide up the leg. And then, like I said, you can, at any time you're in a knee bar, if you want, you can switch out and go to this honey hole saddle position and then you know, work whatever your stuff is from there. So, okay, let's do that, and then we'll be done.
kind of funny, just clowning on people type thing. But if you really like leg locks, it's a way to get the leg locks. I don't know what you were doing in Kesa if you like leg locks. So. But if you accidentally wound up in top position and you're like, oh crap, I don't want to be here. I could be attacking his legs. That's a way to get there. Which I guess also means you, if they have a single hook set when you're escaping the back, you must be able to get to leg locks from there too. That's interesting. That's for another day, though. So, like, basically, that's a back take where he has one hook, and you're using it to set up a leg lock. So that also must mean that from them having your back, you must be able to clear a hook, get your hips over, and make the switch to attacking the leg. I would have to think about that more and pressure test it to see. It's probably not a smart thing to do, but it could be a funny thing. But like I said, that's something that needs further consideration. I'm rambling. Does anyone have any questions over anything?
No, keep rambling, bro.
What your favorite boy band is?
I'm more of a New Kids on the Block.
See, I just don't know anything after 2001.
The Carter Brothers is standalone art.
I had a random one. Anybody remember Andrew W?
You can give them to me or Brian, and then sometime next week I'm going to just drive them down. Their office is here in town, so it's pretty easy to just take the money straight down. So thank you guys for coming. I hope you learned something useful, even if it's just the things that I do, so now you understand what I'm doing and you can start devising ways to beat it. That was part of
ours every weekend.
Throw a third line in my abdomen. These are my favorite two moves. If you roll with me regularly, I probably have done them to you multiple times. Now you know what I'm doing. You can go home and reverse engineer it and figure out how to stop them. And I would appreciate it if you did that, because then I have to evolve too. So cool. Alright.
Good job.
Thank you so much.
Good picture.
Yeah.